All right, 866-969-1969, Colin, if you know anything about the song, who's singing it, who originally sang it.
I have it on my iPhone.
And what year it came out. We do have Google, but we're not using it, you fuckers. This will work. Well, should we just get started because our guests have arrived early? That never happens.
We have our favorite guest, and now we have also our great
Claudia
guest.
Claudia is one of my favorite people.
Well, this I'm so
but
happy.
You never met
meet,
her before.
I'm so happy to meet her because I have so much history with her without her in it.
That's right. I think I'm responsible for the two of you being together.
You
part
did,
of it.
You did.
I made
it more exciting. Claudia Leno. Am I saying your name right?
Lano.
Lano.
But it doesn't matter.
Claudia Lano. He kept correcting me and I kept saying it wrong anyway.
You don't say her name wrong.
Claudia Lano.
Now you say it right.
I'm saying it right. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah,
Claudia Lano.
Yeah.
Who is at one point an actress,
yes.
Now a big shot writer, showrunner,
sure.
Executive producer.
Yeah, that's I've done that.
Okay, yeah, that's good, right? We'll get into more of it.
And
the show
so,
that
so many things.
So many.
And Gary Goldman. Who,
and him.
Who Gary Goldman? Who is hands down in my top probably five favorite comics.
I always get a little nervous when people are on the show that I actually like. Not Gary, but
Claudia. Claudia.
No, but I mean the. Every time, like, if I'm listening to comedy...
Stop looking at me.
Do you mind?
If
honestly,
I'm listening to comedy... I don't want to look at her because I'm very attracted to her.
I know.
Oh,
she's
God.
A pretty girl.
Right from the beginning. And she's successful. And,
I know. She's everything yes, you wanted me to be.
I know. And nice. And her teeth are straight. So what I'm saying is...
You're not done yet, though, Bonnie.
I could get my teeth straight.
You could do any of these things. I mean, you're not going to die later tonight.
Huh? Yeah. Yeah.
Give me a chance.
Yes. Yeah. At 9:15, she is. So... Here's the deal.
Because that's my spot time.
Yeah.
You're such a dick.
We were just discussing what time she was going on tonight, and he, for nobody else except to be cruel, you said that because nobody got the setup.
Was it you or Colin that said? Oh no, I think it was you that said like he's like a savant, like when he's at, like when you're just
yes,
talking to
absolutely.
Him, he has no references, he
no.
doesn't know anything that's going on, he pronounces
no.
all the words wrong.
Played a song, he couldn't tell you who was
no.
singing
no,
it.
But if he was doing like- comedy. Like stuff just comes in.
Yeah. Yeah.
Don't pump him up, you know.
No.
I mean, you're good too.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
I'm all right.
You're okay.
Right.
I can't remember what the point was. Oh, how I brought you together.
Oh yes. Tell the story how Claudia I was writing on a show that Claudia created.
That was a
good show. That was a very funny
I know.
Show.
Fuck everybody. That was a great show.
What was
the
it
name
called?
Of it?
I'm
it
a big slut.
No, they changed it to Good Girls Don't.
Oh.
It started out my best friend is a big fat slut.
Oh,
that
right.
was a fun show.
Yeah. But also, you were a fun boss.
What network?
You were a boss.
What network was in it
Oxygen.
On?
Oxygen.
Oh, it was on Oxygen?
Yes, yeah. But it was like a crazy sitcom on Oxygen.
It was ahead of its time.
Yeah.
That's everything I do.
Yes,
that's
right.
Wait a second. Okay, I got to jump into something after this.
Okay, so we're in the offices, and I was dating you, but I wasn't telling anyone because I didn't do that till after we got married. And yeah, it was like total humiliation. And then then she kept trying to guess who it was. And I said you had a Comedy Central special. One day I caught her Googling everyone who had a Comedy Central special.
Did it throw
special.
Her off when I wasn't fat?
Yes, because I did go through my fat phase, as
okay.
we all do. And if you, it was around 9/11. We were all doing crazy stuff. Then she said to me, whoever he is, get a baby from him.
I said, get that baby.
Yeah.
Wow.
And I did.
That's my philosophy. If you want a baby.
It's good advice, Claudia.
Yeah, don't wait for the right guy. Just get that baby.
Get the baby and then deal with the shit afterwards.
Yeah, I mean, like, if you hit a certain time in life,
mm-hmm.
which I think you had.
Yeah.
Then it's like, if you want a baby, get that fucking baby. And your career, you get that after.
Yeah.
If it's not going well, if you want a baby, get the baby.
Well, that was perfect advice.
Were you ever married?
The blessing.
Yes, I was married.
That is the blessing that is Raina, and all your good traits overwhelmed his...
His
bad,
bad
traits,
ones.
Yeah.
But Gary one time said to me when we were doing Last Comic Standing, he said, and you found out I was dating Rich, and you said, what do you like about him?
You know what? Here's the deal. And
I barely knew you at the time, so I just didn't see it, really.
That's okay. Here's the deal.
But hey, don't act like that question hasn't come up again and again and
well,
again.
Don't act like
again.
You're the Queen of England.
A
right?
lot of people.
Fucking
she
I
is acting like
fire.
She's the Queen of England.
Yeah.
Why do you keep acting like the Queen of England?
I know. Not like she's some, like.
He went, I chew with my mouth closed. He goes, who do you think you are, the Queen of England?
But that's nice. It is nice that you do that, because I don't do that. I don't chew with my mouth.
Neither do I. It's stupid.
I do. I put my hand in front of my mouth. Because
yes.
My husband, you asked, my ex-husband, said I talk with my mouth full.
You guys have kids?
We do have a kid. We're not together anymore.
No, I know. I can see. There's no ring.
Yeah, that's right.
No, but you have a...
I have a long-term boyfriend.
Yes.
That I don't live with.
Is he in the show business?
Yeah.
What's he
one of the funny boys. Jonathan
Schmock.
Schmock.
Valley.
Oh, Schmock. Oh,
I love
God,
the funny boys. You know the funny boys?
You just
got
Valley?
What's that? First of all, I used to...
No, I didn't mean that, Jimmy, if you're listening.
Wait,
but you're not.
Oh, he's the little one, right?
No, I got the big one.
Oh, Schmock was in Ferris Bueller's Day Off.
That's right.
And the other one's the big show runner, though.
Yeah.
And they're genii.
But
they're smartest guys, and their comedy team, the comedy from that was so far ahead of its time.
Wait,
it still holds up.
Thank
it's
you.
Still funny.
Did you see them on the Tonight Show?
No, I saw them on a comics young comedian special, and they did this routine about. King Kong washing the dishes. Yes.
Oh, can you do it? Do you remember
yes.
it?
I just remember that
I just
King
want to
Kong
hear what
was avoiding an agent, a Hollywood
oh,
agent.
That's hilarious.
King Kong was avoiding a Hollywood agent, which is still funny.
I used to book one night when I first started comedy. I booked a couple one-nighters to get work. You know, I would host and make some extra money, and then whoever other guys that were booking one-nighters like me, we would trade. So I, like, at my one-nighter, I had Dennis Wolfberg, Mulrooney.
Wow.
I had Jenny open for Mulrooney.
Richard Jenny.
Yeah, he opened for Mulrooney. Matter of fact, when he was here, he said...
But who's Mulrooney?
Who? Yeah, yeah.
What's his first name?
Who? John Mulrooney.
John Mulrooney.
Back then, he was a big actor. And I had Wolf... Bolster,
I don't think I ever met him.
But I had Joe Bolster, and then I had... Schmock and Valley too, right?
Opening or closing?
They closed. Yeah. You can find. And I used
they were
to
called
one
the that, Funny Boys, which is a terrible name for a brilliant for a brilliant team.
And I used to
maybe
that was part
maybe
of
being
maybe
ironic.
They're being ironic.
Yes,
they were being ironic.
To be like what's a standard name of anything? The most generic name.
Yeah. The Funny Boys.
And we used to do one nighters all the time for like Bellazzo and Jerry Stanley.
What would they pay?
The one nighters.
Yeah.
Like, I
what,
think
you want to get back in?
There were like 60 bucks back then.
Yeah, see, you could get the Funny Boys for 60 bucks.
No, they headlined, so they probably got 100 or whatever, maybe.
Wow.
Back then, but this was, and they'll remember, Bellazzo, Jerry Stanley,
so
Gary Grant.
You gave them their start.
No, I didn't.
And then what did they do for you?
No.
That's what I'd like to know.
Indirectly. It's
indirectly?
Like,
he met you.
It's six degrees of Schmock and Valley.
That's right.
So, okay, so now you've been, how long have you been with him?
17 years.
No.
Oh, my God.
Maybe 16, 17.
But never lived together.
No way.
That is the best.
No,
that is
ever,
amazing.
Never again.
Again.
But you look like brother and sister, you and him, almost.
That's what makes it so hot, you know? I mean, but thank you, I think.
Well, he's like a tall, blonde-haired guy.
Yeah, I'm not tall.
But he's very white.
Yeah, he's super white, and I'm pretending to be.
No, I mean, just like,
yeah.
He has no complexion, pretty much, right?
He's very pale.
Yeah.
He's a pale man.
Okay.
Okay.
So funny. Oh, my God, is he funny.
Yeah, they were. So after they split up as a team, one went on to be...
They were both writing at the time.
Oh, okay.
And they started out, whatever.
Yeah,
but
fuck them.
They worked on Blossom. They created Brotherly Love with Joey Lawrence and
the Golden Girls.
They were on the Golden Girls.
Yeah.
Oh, so they're from that whole era. With
you come across their names a lot in a lot of stuff that you loved. Yeah.
They're from that whole what's his name, Michael Patrick King era from New York. They all.
Yeah. They all. You know. I mean, what
Arrested Development?
Arrested Development. When I was a teenager, and my stepfather's Bud Friedman's partner,
Mark,
and I'd be hang out at the club because you know it's like you have your own bar or something, and every week comics would come in from New York. And
how old were you when this was going on?
18, 19.
Oh, were there any comedians you were particularly attracted to?
besides the one I'm with now.
I mean, who were like the comedians who were like sort of
super hot?
Yeah. Jack Cohen was. The girls loved Jack Cohen.
Cute. Paul Provenza.
Yeah, Provenza.
Provenza. Yes. What about Cesario?
Oh,
I saw Cesario on Johnny Carson the other night.
Oh, yeah, because he always was. He was on all those tapes that I had, too. So before the show started, Gary and I were talking about he was watching The Tonight Show, this old...
Yeah, The Tonight Show with Johnny Carson is rerunning on Antenna TV, full episodes every night.
Oh, really?
And so I record them, and if there's a comedian on, I watch. And the jokes usually don't really hold up. But the ones who became stars, you can tell that they're stars from the moment they walk out.
Yes, like
there.
When
they
Gary Shandling walks out.
Gary Shandling, just, it was, if you didn't know, if you had just tuned in the middle of his act, you'd be like, oh, the Tonight Show has a new host.
Yes.
It's Gary Shandling.
He was the best girl.
You didn't think that Jerry Seinfeld's jokes hold up?
Oh, I said that most of the ones don't hold up.
Okay, but most. I mean, I remember, because, you know, when the guys would get, or ladies... but not as many, but when the guys would get on The Tonight Show, they'd play it at the club. And there were a couple of people where you went, oh, my God, that was a great set. You know?
Like Ellen DeGeneres' first one was ridiculous, and he invited her over to the couch. And, then,
and but they were getting The Tonight Shows, too, and they'd been doing it like 4 and 5 years and stuff, weren't they?
Yeah.
I mean,
she had been doing it 4 years.
Joan Rivers did it for
And he wanted to know why a lot of women weren't being received well as stand-up comedians.
He asked that, Ellen, and what did she say?
She said,
fuck yourself.
The question. He was like, we don't approve of women coming off aggressive, and comedy is a very aggressive act.
Oh my God.
That's what the gist was.
Did she have a bad set, you said?
He would have loved me because
so hard.
I'm not aggressive at all.
Yeah. And she was so confident, and she was 27 years old, but she said during the set, I'm getting old. She was 27 and could have strangled her.
Wow. Wow. Who are some of the other ones?
I saw Riser.
Oh yeah.
You know he? I don't want to say.
But he was Riser from the get go. He had just done Diner.
Yeah, but another comic thought he was doing him.
He was not doing Richard Lewis.
But that wasn't true.
Huh?
He was not. He did not sound like Richard Lewis.
No.
Not at all.
No, so that's not
at
a true story.
You would have to be an incredible.
True. Yeah.
You would have to
Richard
be an
Lewis thinks
Richard
so.
Richard Lewis thought that. Oh my God! I should be careful.
Why?
No one's listening to me.
Nobody listens to this show. Your instincts are absolutely correct.
We're drive time in L.A.
One second before we go
like
further,
drive.
Chuck from Boston, go ahead.
Yeah, the name of the group that sang that song was the Nitty Gritty Dirt Band.
No.
Nitty Gritty.
Yeah, you wanted the year, right?
Okay.
Year, but you're cutting out.
He's from Boston.
Gritty Dirt Band.
Oh, thank you.
No, whatever. Goodbye.
He's calling
866-969-1969 if you want me to be mean, hang up on you, give us a call.
This weekend, Thursday through Sunday, I'll be in Lexington, Kentucky at Comedy Off Broadway. Next weekend in Syracuse.
Oh, is there a reason that you're telling me that?
I'm just throwing it out because I didn't do a plug yet.
That's how they do your schedule with each other, right?
Like,
honey, I'm going out of town. I got to go to Lexington, Kentucky.
Well, I never know where he is, even though he tells me all the time. But I got a lot of stuff in my head. I can't always. So sometimes I ask him questions like, how was the flight? Was it long? Like, I try to get information.
And I drove.
Is it hot? What's the weather like? Yeah, that's happening.
She asked me, how was the flight? I'm in Hartford.
I didn't know. I said that they'd be like, oh, sometimes you fly there, don't you, honey?
So, now, didn't you create or...
let's talk about her stand-up career first.
Oh, Jesus.
Let's talk about your soap career.
Who cares?
No, we do.
I'm here a lot.
Okay.
No,
I'm
no.
Here. I'm not leaving.
Don't worry.
Okay.
That's
a girl problem.
That is
problem.
Such a girl
like,
thing.
I want to make sure
you're being very generous, but I'm fine.
Okay, good.
I don't like how aggressive you are.
She's a little over-aggressive.
Your dad was always so nice to me.
Was he?
Always
You may be the only person who's
her stepdad. Oh, stop
it.
Same with Bud. I mean, I used to go in there and have dinner with Bud and this, you know, and whenever I worked Vegas, Bud would take us out to dinner. One night I had dinner alone with Bud in Vegas. It was
I had to have breakfast once with him in
Aspen?
No, it was Montreal and he was going to get roasted. And so he saw me waiting in line, and he waved me over to have lunch with him. And I was uncomfortable. I didn't know how to talk to him just by myself. And then he was asking me all these roast jokes if they were good. And I was like, that one's really funny.
I didn't know what to do.
Actually, your mom, too. I know your mom because when I was in Vegas last, I think Kathleen Madigan had some kind of party.
Yeah, yeah.
Don't they manage Kathleen?
They did. They did. They did.
And she was having a party at Caesars or something.
Okay. I believe you.
I don't know. I was
somewhere. My mom was a comic.
But your mom's always so nice, too.
She's very nice.
Yes. No. I'm saying.
I'm not even kidding. She's very nice. She's charming.
She remembers your name.
Your name.
Yes.
She'll ask about your children. She'll want to.
She's one of those people that actually gives a shit about other people.
She loves talking to people, and she's charming.
Very nice.
She's delightful.
Yeah, that sounds like my mother. My mother's a real charmer too.
Yeah.
Is she?
Yeah. Oh my God, you would adore her.
Ask Bonnie, what did my mother say when she first heard you?
When his mother, I was upstairs still getting ready, and Rich had gone and picked her up and brought her to our house. And this was my first time meeting her. And I said, I'll be right down. She goes, oh my God, it sounds like a man. But it only got worse after that. So, no, one time I said to Rich, she was in a nursing home. And, well, she still is, but she doesn't really communicate that much anymore. But he would press her buttons, you know, when every time he went to visit her.
Push her buttons.
Oh, okay. Canada, we say press her buttons.
When you were, and since she's in a nursing home, I thought there were buttons there.
Oh.
You have to press to communicate with her, you know, like in that Star Trek.
Yes.
The red and the blue. Captain Pike.
So he would go in and be, you know, kind of aggressive and rude. And I said, why don't you just try being nice? Why don't you start by asking her how she is instead, you know? So he goes in one day and he goes, hey, how are you? And she goes, how the fuck do you think I am? So it didn't really work out.
She doesn't communicate anymore.
All right, okay, so let's talk about your acting career first. Because you've had many careers.
Yes.
You had an acting career. Did you start, like, going on auditions when you were a teen?
I did. I my stepfather was an actor at the time. Oh my God, I've got dry mouth. I'm so sorry, people.
She's so high.
Yeah, always high. And his agents came over for dinner, and I was already, like, you know, very show businessy, and you know, like Tracy Flick from Election, but show business. And so I brought out my guitar and I played my song that was my big signature song of the time, which was Fuck the World.
Nice.
And they said, oh, we'll send her out on
things. By the Nitty Gritty Dirt Band?
No, by the Claudia Lano. And they sent me out on things, and I got, you know.
How long did it take before you got something?
like 3-4 months. I mean, when I started, I didn't, you know, it was all, she probably won't get anything, but it's good experience, you know. But then I did, and like the week I got my first job, which was on a very short-lived show called, it was the Mary Tyler Moore Hour, but it wasn't the variety hour. Uh-huh. It was the sitcom slash variety show.
No.
Which was like, part of it was a sitcom, and then part of it was a sitcom about behind the scenes of, it was like Larry Sanders.
Oh,
oh wow.
And then you saw the variety show. And so I was on that, and I had a big part, like a huge part. And the week I was doing that, I auditioned for Knots Landing.
But wait. So you worked with Mary Tyler Moore, and you met her and talked with her and became...
I played her goddaughter on the show.
Was she a nice person?
Yes, she was very nice. I mean, she was nice. I think it was tense. Because of, oh, this was like maybe her second attempt after the original Mary Tyler Moore show. And there was like singing and, I mean, I'll never forget. She did, Johnny Mathis was the guest. I'm a million years old. Johnny Mathis was the guest on the variety show portion. And he sang Last Dance, which went on forever. And then he did a medley with Mary Tyler Moore.
I love medleys.
Yeah, which was, she liked the country, whereas he liked the city.
Oh, that's
and I could do
perfect.
do the whole thing for you.
Everybody from the Mary Tyler Moore Show, everyone got their own sitcom. Yeah. Every cast member.
Oh, yeah.
Even though
a successful one, right?
Everyone. Actually, Lou Grant.
That's how it worked back
yes.
then. Yeah.
Rhoda,
everyone.
All of them.
Rhoda!
Ted, all of them.
Even that one?
All of
even
them.
Even Rhoda.
Every single one. That's how powerful that show was, and she was in Hollywood.
Yeah.
And the fact that you were working with her is probably... Like,
but then she went on to a big role on Knott's Landing.
Never saw it.
Oh, well,
Knott's Landing was huge.
Yes,
it was like
one of the longest.
It was bigger than
shows.
Sex and the City. Yeah. I mean, you can't compare the popularity and how penetrating those shows were in the
oh,
minds
right,
of Americans.
Oh, right, because probably they had more viewers than anything
more viewers
today.
Than anything.
Yeah.
Probably all the TV watchers combined.
Yes, that's
I mean,
true.
Knott's
yes.
Landing was huge.
Yeah, and it was big.
It was a spinoff of Dallas, right?
That's
yeah.
right, man.
Yeah.
Sorry, how do you know that?
Because I used to watch it with my mother. It was a Friday night show,
oh,
right?
Oh, my God. Yeah.
And what part were you on it?
I played Michelle Lee's daughter. Teenage daughter, bitchy, mouthy teenage. You know, most of
it goes
my,
exactly what we think about
every
the,
daughters. Every daughter on television.
Every yes, teenage daughter right. on television
every
is an asshole.
Is a total.
On the Americans, on 25, on everyone.
Every show, and yes. my daughter's delightful.
Yeah.
You know, I think they just, well, you know what it is? They want to create stories for the older actress. That's,
right,
I mean,
right,
so
right.
if you're not a problem, she's got nothing to do.
Right.
You know,
right.
she's got a, oh, I'm worried, where'd she go? Why is she so upset?
When everyone's a Jewish mom.
Where'd
oh,
you go?
God.
What's happening now? Why'd she make that face? I don't know. I better go up and talk to her. And, you know, I did that for 6 years.
You were on Knott's Landing for 6 years.
Yes, I did.
Every week? You weren't on every week, were you?
No, well, but I was like 10
years.
Out of 13.
Ridiculous.
So, you
wow,
know,
yeah.
like a lot. There was a big, it was a big cast.
You got to sit on the couch.
I was on that couch.
On Johnny Jesus. Carson, just because you were an actress on that show.
That's
how big it was.
Well, and also I was hanging out at the club and I became friends. You know, I was a party person and my stepfather owned a bar and I drank for free and underage, which I guess is bad. And so I was hanging out with Jim McCauley and he booked the Tonight Show.
Oh,
yeah. He liked to drink. So, you know, so that's how I got on.
And then, like, and then is that where you start, when you started doing stand up or you waited till
oh,
after?
Oh, no. I was doing stand up on and off since I was 15. I mean, I got up, I went on the New York improv audition night, back when Chris Albrecht managed it with that
God.
Song.
He now runs HBO, is it? No,
no
he's
stars.
Got his own.
Stars.
Now
oh, stars.
Stars yeah.
He was a doorman. No, he was a manager there.
He managed.
Danny Aiello was a doorman there.
Yeah,
at the
yeah.
improv.
Les Moonves was a bouncer.
Was
wow.
he?
Yeah, or a bartender.
I started at the wrong.
Yeah,
I remember
no,
going to
no,
the wrong
no,
places.
You started the right place.
Yeah, no, well, I remember.
Should have just been a door guy.
Door guys clean up.
Yeah, they really
that's
do
true.
Well.
That's true, yeah.
So then.
Then, so.
So you don't, you did not
say. We always have arguments when we're interviewing people.
That's
well,
great.
Well, I've been letting you ask all. I've only asked a couple.
No, you asked them all. I didn't, just said nothing.
I
said
didn't ask
nothing
any.
So
what
far.
Are you talking about?
No, go ahead.
About?
Do the show your fucking self. Okay.
Go ahead. You ask. I haven't asked any. I asked one or two. You were talking Knott's Landing. Go ahead. After Knott's Landing.
After Knott's Landing, I had to recover. Quote unquote, from that.
From what?
He had exhaustion.
Yeah, from quote unquote exhaustion. You know, and all that stuff. And I started doing stand up and I started writing. And at a certain point, and I was a okay comic. Like, I wasn't that great.
But your jokes were great, right? Didn't some of your jokes go on to fame and fortune?
Better than Jen Karen.
And Karen did the Tonight Show twice. Or Letterman.
No, she did Carson. Not Letterman. Go ahead.
Letterman
too.
Yeah. She was not so bad. She was good.
What made you stop doing stand-up, and were you aware that you weren't going to do it again when you the last time you did stand-up?
That's a good question. I had a baby, and
there you
like
go.
The, but it wasn't just that. It was like right when I was just sort of getting, you know, like I was middling, and I got on some TV shows. Like that recession hit that, and like half the clubs across the country
right.
closed, and it just became like, you know, they're not going to pay your travel or they're paying you less. I just couldn't see the point anymore.
Yeah.
And, I started writing. So, and like I had one big sort of whatever, hallelujah moment, I had an opportunity to write a script for something. And it was like my first one. And they liked me, and I was going to have to go back and pitch this story, and I had never done it before. And by this time, I'm sleeping on my parents' floor. I've left my husband. I got all my monies in a coffee can. I mean, like, I'm like, I thought I was fucked up before. Now I got this baby. And in the middle of getting it together to do this pitch, my agent called and said I had an audition to go straight for to producers. And I thought to myself, I'm probably going to get this writing job, but I know I won't get the acting job. So tell them I'm not coming. That's it.
We're what done. Was it for?
I don't even remember. It's just like, it was like, you know, a guest star or something. But like, it was so
But the
hard.
Writing was more important.
The writing was more
did
important.
Did you get it? The writing did?
Yeah, I did.
What was it for?
It was for a, you know, a non-union show called The Young Adventures of Robin Hood. Like, they shot in Bosnia or something. You know, and it was like an hour comedic action adventure. I don't think I did a great job, but, you know, I got the money.
But wait, because I missed you from this text. Were you going on the road doing stand-up?
Yeah,
you,
yeah, yeah.
As a headliner?
No, middle.
As a middle?
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, yeah.
And then the writing's never stopped.
No, it's never stopped. And then I created that show. That was like a big deal.
That was the first show that you created. Then you went on to create... Didn't you have like three shows on the air at one point?
No,
or
not at, like at the same time.
Two shows on the air at some
no,
point?
No, no. I mean, I had two pilots going at the same time once. But I've created like four shows. Not like, you know, big hits.
Didn't you do the one recently with Brad Garrett?
Yes.
He's so nice.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know. I work his club.
Yeah.
And he always texts his great show. Thank you. He's the nicest guy.
I thought he was fantastic. I mean, he was brilliant. I mean, that show was dear to my heart.
He's a good actor.
That show was great.
He was so good on Fargo.
What's the name of the show?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Oh.
How to Live With My Parents.
Oh, How to Live With Your Parents for the Rest of Your Life. That was autobiographical. Elizabeth Perkins, Sarah Chalk, John Doerr.
Who we know.
Yeah, yeah.
John Doerr, are you listening? He listens to our show.
Yes. Oh, hi, John.
Yes. Very funny.
Yeah, you know, he's hugely funny. Talented. I love that guy. He's super nice.
Yeah, yeah, very funny.
He was great. And Joe Wengert, who's a comic and a UCB guy, who's great.
I don't like him. But John Doerr is fantastic.
John Doerr.
No, I don't know the other guy.
It's so funny. When you work Brad's room in the MGM, the first time I worked there, I do a show, and then I get a text, you know, good show. I go to the manager, I go, who's this? They go, Brad. Well, he has a closed circuit at his house. He could watch his shows.
That's hilarious.
You know, at home, which is great.
That's
you know,
really cool.
It's smart. It's his club. I would do it, too. But I would have liked to known that. I mean, this is the first time, because, you know, I might have, but whatever. But he's always been the nicest guy. Even when you opened for him. Remember when you opened for Brad?
Yeah, I opened for him a few times.
It was only once.
I think it was twice at that theater. Same, we came back the next year.
We came back and did it ourselves.
Why don't you go fuck yourself? Frank!
Is it time for me to tell my Brad Garrett story?
Yeah.
Well, wait, can you just wait till, because I got Frank now on.
Oh, yeah.
Unless you ask Frank if he wants to wait.
I'll be more than happy to wait. Do I sound like Raymond?
Yeah, a little bit.
I get that.
Yeah.
I actually wanted to sound like the brother, but I'll wait for his story.
Oh. Okay, he's going to wait for your story. Go ahead, Gary.
No, I feel it's been built up too much.
Okay, go ahead.
Yeah, well, are you doing my brother?
No, he was doing Robert from Everybody Loves Raymond.
Oh, because you also sound like my brother. But my brother's semi-famous.
Your brother's one of my
Michael
favorite
Rappaport.
Actors.
Yeah, so he, that's not crazy.
Okay, yeah,
he can do the voice. He sounds like that when he wants to.
I listen to him a lot.
It did sound like him, you're right.
Yeah, that's why
he's fucking hilarious.
Who?
And he really knows his basketball, too.
Oh, my God.
He made a doc. He's good friends with Gullup. He's good friends with Bob. Yeah.
Oh, he's great friends with Bob. Yeah. He loves Bob.
Yeah, because their kids play ball or whatever.
I mean.
Is he not? Or are you just kidding?
Serious. Like, wow, Bob.
Yeah, but I was... Yeah, I mean...
Not like there's anything, I'm just saying.
Yeah, it sure
and
is.
He also has, like, the cutest little girl in the...
Who, Bob?
I mean, like, this kid is...
You know, I'm going to have Bob... I might tell Bob to call in later.
Yeah, tell Bob to call.
Frank, go ahead. Tell Claudia what you want.
Claudia, I've been following your career a little bit. I grew up... I know your brother. I just want to tell you that you only look more and more beautiful as you age.
Oh, that's so nice.
Are you pickled? Are you drinking a lot of wine, maybe? Is that what it is?
No, no wine at all. Never.
Wow. You know, Rich is 30 years
good guess,
oh,
though.
Me too.
30 years sober.
Wow.
30?
Yeah.
Me too?
Yeah.
I'm
oh my God.
Holding my chip right now.
Are you guys falling in love?
No, I saw you had the tattoo.
Which, oh, right here?
Yeah.
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 We're all the same, then. I've been drunk for 30 years.
Frank, you're a oh, riot. Frank.
Good one, Frank.
All right, hung up on him.
Yeah, that sounds like
866-969-1969.
It's so funny when I'm in a club and I'll go, I'm sober, and one person will go, boo. I go, really? You go out on the Friday or Saturday, have your beers, all right? You're, you know, like, whoa, you're just a wild man, you know, on the weekends. But they don't know what fucking... you know what I mean?
Yeah, they don't know.
I did a convention 2 weeks ago. It's probably one of the biggest ones. It's the second biggest next to World for a 12-step fellowship. Northern California.
Uh-huh.
5,000 people there.
Wow.
5,000. My show was only about 600.
Can you please tell the Dr. Oz story? Is it Dr. Oz?
That was great.
Was he there?
No, this is another one.
Oh,
I was doing.
Oh, I thought that was the one.
This, I got a call to host... They were having a thing in D.C. Out on the Monument.
Can and you swallow? Was,
okay. I am.
Okay.
It was in the... hold on. In the, okay. How many times have I asked you that?
And you know what? I just want to interrupt. I don't get that. What do you give a shit what I do with the cum when I'm done?
Yeah,
I mean,
right.
Do I have to act? We're done.
It's
aren't
just
you?
How lazy they are. They don't want to pick up a fucking sock and wipe their chest.
I don't even understand. Like, I don't get
my I don't know. It's just, I'll tell you why. Because if you
difference?
Swallow it, it's just really, really nasty. And,
no.
and that's
no.
a turn on.
But
yes!
You,
don't answer for me.
Yes. I'm saying to her, no.
I'm just
why?
Saying.
I agree with you.
I'm just saying, aren't you just
because
like,
it means you're very, very bad. And you're naughty.
No.
And look at you.
Or you can't take doing? It. You can't take it off your chest and put it in you and have a baby. Okay? Once it's in you.
Oh, that, well, I that never, does make sense.
I've never been that
really?
Paranoid.
Yeah. Really?
That I can see. I mean, I can't think of anybody who'd do that. Sounds fucking crazy.
That is crazy.
Like, you need to find out who these girls are first. That sounds insane.
I just yeah. like it.
Why are you so right for you?
Hey, I'm all good with everything. I'm just saying when people are like, you know, like, have an objection, I go, you fucking, I'm like,
listen,
hey, how about I make you a sandwich?
Hey,
is that okay?
Psycho sober lady. I only made a joke. I don't give a fuck if she swallows it or not.
I wasn't talking to you specifically. Okay. I meant as a general,
right.
Like as a comedic trope of a thing where people like yeah. have a big like
they
this is
it.
A complaint.
Right.
Yeah.
I prefer the swallow, but
you're gonna break up with a gal and
no,
she won't.
No, it's not a deal breaker. It's completely optional.
Yeah, it's guilty.
I'm fine either way.
Yeah.
Either way.
You can't. All right, but go on with your thing.
Would you rather, though, just before we get too much into it, would you rather have a blowjob or actual sex?
I'd rather have actual sex.
How about you?
Huh?
Oh, my God.
I'd rather give... I don't know. It depends what part of the house
you'd rather
it's
give
in.
A blowjob? Is that what
no,
you were going to
no,
say?
No, you're disgusting. I would rather... I'd
am
rather...
I
don't know about getting... I don't know. It's just all the same. I'd rather play golf. I'd rather play golf. To tell you the truth. What
well,
the fuck?
What?
I don't care.
That's crazy.
What's crazy? Look at you guys. I'm old.
I guess.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I can't. We have sex. We have, either way.
Then how come if I say no, you get all offended?
I don't get offended. We do it like, you know, when we do it, we do it. Don't make a face at me like we
oh,
don't.
Why are you like, mm-hmm.
Okay, you know, we've had some good sex lately.
We do
not
it on each
one.
Of our birthdays.
Yes. The last one was bad.
It was
I
bad.
Could, yeah, I came too quick. I got too excited.
Oh, don't worry about that. I mean, you know,
yeah,
it's
but my clothes weren't even off.
I was still folding laundry. It was embarrassing.
I'm always saying, you know, when you're with somebody
no.
for a while, it's like let's get off our own backs here. You know, we'll do this again.
Yes.
We don't have to have a great day every fucking. I mean, it takes more, you know, energy.
No, we do pretty good.
Yeah, I bet you do great.
That's why I like right. the blowjob. It just you know,
I wrote a whole bit about it, but I said to her the other night that you know, can I go down? I'll go down on you. You don't have to do anything in return. You know,
and wow.
This is a bit. This is a bit.
No,
I believe he prefaced it with, "I wrote this bit." I've never heard that before.
I said the other night. I said to you, "I go, do you want me to eat your puss?" Remember, I said that to you.
Yeah.
And you said, "You go."
But doesn't that just the way you said it?
Hey,
turn
you want me to eat your
yes,
puss?
Yes, that's exactly.
Hey, I'm here.
If he wants,
I'm saying.
If he wants to have sex, he throws a bottle of lube at me.
Oh, my God.
You can't eat your own puss, right? You can't do it yourself, so I'm here.
That's what I was saying. I was going to do it.
Hey, I'll do it.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Get a baby nice. From him.
She's like, I didn't tell you you had to marry him to get a baby from
no,
him.
No, no, no. I'm glad you're happy.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
That's right.
I know. I'm
happy. I am happy.
I know you are. You're happy. You're happy.
I am. I love him. I don't know why, but.
He's great. Don't
He drives
don't
me
don't,
fucking crazy.
Well, you know, I bet you, you know.
Yeah. Yes.
What you're going to say? I'm not such a. I'm amazing.
Anybody drives anybody crazy in close quarters. That's why I don't live with my boyfriend.
I think that's so genius.
Yeah, I can't. It's not.
I
like,
love him more when he's on the road. I'll tell you that.
I, you know, a little break. What's the matter with that? And we see, you know, we're that. It's all good. It's like 24 hours a day. Man, I don't
Does
know.
Does your daughter still live with you, or she's gone to college?
She's in college. That's why I'm here.
Where does she go to college?
Oh.
Sarah Lawrence.
Nice.
Thank you.
Wow.
Good,
she's
good.
Smart.
Huh?
Where's Sarah Lawrence?
It's in Bronxville.
Ah.
I was just there this morning.
Ah. I was going to ask you what you're doing here.
Yeah, I came to see her in a show, or she directed a show.
Oh, so she's going to be a writer-director also?
Actress, yes.
Oh, everything.
The whole
family.
She had a weekend off, so she directed a show. That's had nothing to do in college. Hey, you know what? Maybe I'll direct a show. What do you think she's going to do?
She's very lovesick.
I'm glad you don't like sex anymore.
Why? Oh, you're threatening me with sex?
Well, no, I'm not threatening you with sex.
Well, ask another question.
Everybody's uncomfortable when they come in here.
Well, you know, the show is called My Wife Hates
That's
Me.
That's true.
So I got to do a little hating. And then...
how come their names aren't up there
what
anyway?
The fuck happened here? Lewis, we fire him twice a show.
No.
We have to hire him.
It's terrible. I mean, nobody else will work this cheap, unfortunately. So we're stuck with him. But we were at the bank yesterday.
Yes.
And...
You can't recreate a story where you...
This is the thing.
Okay.
Every time we're in a public where there's, like, fancy people... You know, regular.
Oh, they were real fancy.
Suited, whatever. They're wearing suits.
Oh, they're so fancy at Bank of America.
They're, you know, he'll make some joke about hitting me or, you know, some sexual thing. Or and then he's making jokes about me dying. And
no, you made one about me being old and dying.
Yeah, but that was appropriate and cute, what I said.
You're delusional.
And thank
You're
you.
Fucking delusional.
And at one point, he showed me something on his phone, and I asked him another question about it. And he goes, "I just fucking showed it to you. It's right in front of your face." That's what he said.
What are you talking about? What's one?
You were showing me about how much money was going to go into that account.
All
right,
for
you don't have to get into details about...
Yeah, because you're wrong.
Okay, it doesn't matter, that part. The part that matters is that in front of
regular people,
he yelled at me, and they don't know how to handle it. And then every single time, no matter what, I'm always like this. Stop it right now. You stop it right now.
Or it's like people giving
because
you,
because he doesn't know how to control his emotions.
Like cards for, like, domestic violence shelters.
Yes. No, he does. Since we're in Walmart, he makes a joke about, she's going to have to buy makeup, you know. Like, and people, they laugh because they're so uncomfortable, and he thinks, I'm making people happy wherever I go. But that's not what's happening.
I kill online at Walmart.
Yeah.
Okay?
They laugh.
They laugh because they're unevolved.
No, they honestly are laughing like this.
Oh, really?
No, she pushes buttons. She don't.
Oh, do I press buttons?
No, you push buttons
I'm taking care of the taxes. I know how all the financial. And she goes, that's not what you told me. And it is what I told her, but she doesn't take it in because she's stupid. She's smart when it comes to directing and writing and all
that.
I
got to see that thing. I didn't even know.
What?
About the movie.
You never saw our movie? You never saw our movie?
No. I mean, like, it sounds like the greatest thing in the world.
I wrote a book. Did you know that?
You read the book?
I bought the book, and I'm reading the book.
I finished it.
I love the book.
You did?
I finished it a few days in.
It's very competitive.
Couldn't put it down. Well, I wanted to plug it.
Okay.
That was the whole thing.
I love the book. The book is fantastic.
Yeah. I loved it.
Yeah.
Aw, thanks.
It was riveting. It was riveting.
Yeah.
And I hadn't read a book in months. I couldn't concentrate. And then I picked up that. I got it on a Kindle. It was $9.99.
Oh, I thought you were going to say, like, I got it at the bargain bin.
No. That's got to be the worst, to find your memoirs in a bargain bin.
Oh, my God.
For, like, a dollar. Oh, my God.
Well, this is another thing. The book is at our local Barnes & Noble, and Rich has to go and find a guy who works there. The whole time
he's
saying,
standing by us.
No, please, don't do it. No, please. He goes, she wrote this book!
I said you want her to sign
and
a couple.
It's so embarrassing.
Yeah. No.
He's proud of you.
I said, hey, here's the
I know,
there.
But it's...
She can sign a couple of these, and when people buy them, they'll have hers. I said,
and the guy understood. He said, I see you're very proud of your daughter.
Well, the thing is that he can't believe, because he loves being the center of attention.
No,
so
that's
much,
not true.
That he cannot believe that I don't want to be. Like, that I just like to go through, blend
in. But whether
in.
You know it or not, he is the good word that precedes you. When he's not talking to me, but he's talking to other people, talking about how Bonnie's done this, Bonnie's done that.
I know that.
Yes,
he's good.
I brag about you. I'm your walking
but
resume.
But when Margaret Cho was in here, and he goes to me, not on our show, we were on Opie's show,
right.
And he goes, shut up, stupid. To me, and she goes, don't you call her that. And it's like, I have to pretend I'm some bad. I'm like, oh, Jesus, this is all in fun. You know, it's like, it's crazy. You know, people don't understand that.
People don't understand how you just dig, and you don't know because you're not smart. You're smart, but you're not like, no.
You see? Do you feel it? Like,
anger? Like my parents are like this. I'm not even kidding. Although I don't feel like my mother digs. She's more manipulative.
Yeah, she digs. So, like, I'm taking care of taxes. It's very stressful. And she goes, that's not what you told me, but it is.
Well, I've always wanted to get a shut up stupid from Rich Voss. I don't feel that we're close enough for him to say shut up stupid.
It doesn't even register to me
one
anymore.
Of my favorite people.
I know, but you never say shut up stupid.
Because you're not. you're one of the only people I listen to on, like, if I'm listening to comedy, right when I hear a certain voice, I'll turn it off. But if I hear you, I listened to you yesterday.
It's really
and he
nice.
Masturbates. Did you know that?
No. I mean, it was an older bit, and no one should really care that much about grapefruit or grapes. But I still listen. Okay? So shut up, stupid. That's what I fucking listen to it, though.
Have you ever heard Gary Goleman?
He's one of the best comics.
Yeah, I've seen Gary.
Not to put you in a weird position.
No, I love
I don't care for it.
No.
Not my cup of tea. I understand that.
Somebody stopped me at Caroline's one night and they said, hey, were you on Letterman last night? I go, yeah. And she goes, I didn't care for it.
No.
Swear
oh, my God. What was the point of that?
Yeah,
it's weird, right?
Why would somebody be so
cool? I have no idea. Do that?
Thoughtless.
God, I hate that person.
Yeah.
I hate everybody.
That was my mom.
No.
In all fairness, my mother...
story. When did that happen?
Oh, yeah. The day after I did Letterman. I think it was the second Letterman. No.
You did three Lettermans, right?
Yeah. And that was the second. Shut up. You're so embarrassing.
But you did three Lettermans.
Stop it. Put your hat
back on. Do you know
how
many... How many females have done three Lettermen?
Lots, I'm sure.
No.
Okay.
No.
Right. Not you. Not like
the Booker had an expressed. He expressed a dislike for booking female comedians.
Is that true?
Yes, in the New York Times.
So Eddie,
but he didn't book me.
I don't
want to
say his name.
One.
It was in the New York Times.
Eddie Brill.
I didn't say his last name. She did. It could have been any Eddie.
Whatever, Eddie Brill. He used to book the
Eddie Cantor.
He used to book Letterman.
Eddie Cantor on Joe Franklin.
He still worked at Letterman, you know, after that. It was a New York Times article that sort of somehow, I felt like that was
it was a miracle that you got even one appearance on that show and you did three.
Well, at that point, I'd already done two. But I just wrote a thing saying, like, he does book women, I've done it, but I just want people to know it does nothing for your career. It doesn't help at all. So it don't matter, ladies. And then after, there was another booker that booked me for the third one.
Okay.
Who was the last booker? Zoe used to book that.
Yeah,
way back. She gave me
them.
My first TV, American TV spot.
Who, Zoe did?
Late Night.
No,
yeah.
Caroline's.
No, Late Night.
What, for Letterman?
With Craig Kilborn.
No, it was
Kilborn.
Craig Kilborn.
Oh.
Which I was getting my hair done, and the gal who's supposed to be doing my hair and makeup was on a phone call crying, trying to get back together with her boyfriend. And the show was going, and my hair was, I was like, I said, should I start? She was like, and so I started doing my own hair. And then when she finished her phone call, she looked at me and she goes, oh, God, no. And then I just had to put it in a ponytail and get out there.
Oh,
no.
But see, yeah. But you're, you know, but you're so beautiful. It doesn't matter. I don't even know why I care enough. I don't know. I'm making it better.
I didn't care that much. I just kept thinking, like, is anyone going to come in here and tell her to get started on my hair?
Yeah, fuck that.
Why didn't you?
I did. I did do my hair, but I wasn't great with a curling iron, and so it got a little kinky.
Oh.
But it was fine.
I put a new iron today for the house. I got a good iron.
Like, for clothes?
Yeah, I got
Rich
a nice
loves
one.
To iron.
I got a nice iron.
I used to do segments on Last Comic Standing of Rich Voss ironing his shirts.
This is the kind of titillating...
His Ted Baker shirts.
If you're listening to this in your car, you might want to pull over. It's getting quite exciting.
I lost all of my Ted Bakers in the fire. In our fire. We're not getting any calls. Give us a call. 866-969-1969. We have two great guests. Ask them whatever you want. 866-969-1969.
Well, we should give a topic. We should come back after the break with a topic or something. People call in about that topic.
We're not a topic.
Do you like girls to swallow, let's say?
Ugh. Come on. We're not a dirty show. We're an informative.
Well, I was the one who started that. So today you are.
Okay.
No, we say fucking fucked up shit constantly. Are you kidding me? Brother.
All right, let's get some more energy going in here. This weekend, I'll be in Lexington, Kentucky. Comedy off Broadway. Next weekend, Syracuse. The weekend after that, the Stress Factory.
Oh, Gary's
doing theaters.
Our Lewis. Was your Comedy Central special titled Boyish Man?
Two specials ago.
Okay, yeah, but didn't Tig? What was hers called?
Mannish Boy.
Mannish Boy.
I just made that up.
No, Mannish Boy.
Oh, Mannish Girl.
Was a Muddy Waters. Was a Muddy Waters song, and it was a play on that. So Tiggs probably was a play on that as well. Yeah. But I get a new special that's coming out on Netflix this spring called It's About Time.
It's just how many hours have you done to you?
And that's what? A Girl Finally Swallowed?
One half.
It's your third 1 hour special?
What is that in reference?
Yes. That's fucking insane.
It's not insane. It's about right for how long I've been doing this.
Yeah, I know, but it's just great. It's insane that, you know what I mean?
I'm very proud of it.
You should be.
Thanks.
Look at this. In our notes here, it says who you're dating since 2015. It really did. Is that on your wiki page or something?
Well, it might be on my wiki page, but I didn't put it there.
Oh.
It's absurd. Here's who I'm dating.
Are you guys going to ever get married?
I'm a nobody. Are we going to get married? I don't know. Probably, yeah.
Do you want to have kids?
No.
You don't?
No.
Like never?
Why? I just I don't want to pass on my...
In a House of Cards last night we were watching, the one woman said, do you regret not having kids? To Claire. And Claire goes, do you regret having kids? Genius answer.
Anything else you want to repeat from TV?
And then I was watching Game of Thrones. And
I watched Walking Dead. So
we've never
if anybody
seen an
wants,
episode.
Are you fucking kidding me?
Never one.
Oh, yeah? Have you seen The Wire?
No.
Are you kidding me?
No.
It's the best show ever.
You would love that. That's brilliant.
Is it? Yeah. But it's real, and The Walking Dead's not.
Right.
And I'm a science fiction person.
Oh, okay.
So anybody wants
were you
to
a fan
ask
of Lost?
Yes.
Oh, didn't you love Lost?
That was like the first real bingey show, right?
I'll watch any fucking thing where there's a spaceship or an apocalypse.
Why don't you write a movie like that? Wouldn't that be a good
because,
movie?
Because, you know, you got a lot
she
of...
has too much respect for the genre to dabble in it.
No, I think I... Like,
shut up, stupid. That would have been a perfect time.
The character stuff, I think I'd be great at, but all the blah, blah, we got to get the virus.
You don't feel like Googling.
No, look, you know,
get a co-writer.
I'm really, yes, all right. You sound like my parents.
Come on. Come what on, are you working on?
I'm working on a lot of things.
What do you got? Can you tell us some stuff?
Yeah, I mean, I'm writing a screenplay to direct.
Oh, that's good. Happens.
So that would be something. I directed that short film. So that was I did that like last year.
I didn't get to see your short film.
I didn't see the short film.
But I'm going to watch it.
That's not me.
Oh, fuck.
Oh, that's not me. That's not me.
Transparent's a great show, though.
Wait, why
did our friend Jill Soloway?
Yes, our friend. Or she helped me get into the directing thing.
Oh, what, cool.
Yeah.
What can you please, I'm asking you, go to this guy, Chris. Why do I have him worried?
Go ahead, Chris from Phoenix.
Yeah, thanks, Rich Voss. I just got done hooking up with a girl a couple days ago, and as a gentleman, she didn't want to swallow. I blew my load on her chest, and she went into the bathroom, and the whole time I'm thinking, oh, my God, I hope she doesn't, like, take my cum and put it in her vagina, and now Rich brings it up that a girl could do that, so now I'm even more worried than I was before.
How do you think I got a baby in
me? It's called scooping.
Oh, is that really the term?
I just made that up. That's really
it's very convincing, though. But why is this tablespoon of jizz known as a load?
Yes, exactly. Well,
talk about narcissism. My load.
I was worried about a baby was bad enough, but now I got Rich Voss's face in my head, so that just makes it worse.
Well, when your baby's born, you can call him Rich.
I'm
gonna call him fucking Voss.
I love fucking Arizona. Scottsdale, I fucking love Scottsdale.
Oh, wait, dude. Thanks for calling, Chris. Yes,
good luck.
Yeah. Also, we haven't done this in so long, and I think we should do this when we get back from the break so people think about it. We used to fix people's lives. Do you remember that? This
has
started off as a call-in show for relationships, and we would, like,
help people
with relationships, and then we just, I don't know.
We
got tired of their fucking bullshit.
And then you two assholes came in, and nobody called, so maybe we should fucking do that again.
How about Scott in Wisconsin? We got a call. Scott in Wisconsin. I'll be out. Oh, no. What part of Wisconsin?
Oh, did he vote?
Scott.
No, I'm here, yeah. Where am I in Wisconsin? Well, I live in central Wisconsin, Stevens Point, about an hour and a half north of Madison.
How far are you from Minneapolis? Like, I play a golf course right outside Minneapolis. Oh, okay. Troy Byrne. I know, it's kind of boring. Go ahead. Yeah. So you want to know my opinion on Anthony going into rehab?
Yeah, Jimmy kind of, you know, said a little bit about the situation. I don't know if he talked to you at all. I know he went to Ronnie and kind of talked to him about it, and was that something that he decided he wanted to do? And
I don't know, Anthony. I didn't talk to Anthony. I know I'm supposed to fill in for his show next week. I heard he's going to rehab. I don't know why he's going to rehab. I don't know if he's going for himself or other. Here's the deal.
He thinks
rehab.
He can meet somebody there.
Here's the
what
deal.
What do you mean, why is he going?
No, because some people, there's different reasons people go to rehab.
Name two.
One, because you want to get clean and sober. Or one, because the courts are making you.
That would be number two.
Three, or three, you don't want, you want to go in case you're going to court. Or one, you're trying to appease your wife, your family, your kid, whatever. But here's the deal. And this is only from my experience. Once you surrender to the disease of alcoholism or drug addiction, you have a better shot of staying clean or sober. Once you say, this is it, I'm done, I can't win. Now, also, too, I used to think, well, this person's going to rehab because his wife wants him, or
Lewis,
the courts are making him. But what I'm saying is, and I used to go, well, that guy or girl, is taking up bed space from somebody who needs to be there. But that person might hear something in rehab, or might feel something or see something that might turn them around. So you never know why. It doesn't matter why you're there. It's what you get out of it while you're there. Does that make sense?
Yeah, that sounds good.
You
I
know,
like that.
So I don't know why he went. Hopefully, the end game is he decides to get sober and his life will get better. I don't know if his life will get better, but his life will change. There you have it.
Yeah, that was good.
So that's all I could tell you.
Well, we have a segment about when Rich talks about sobriety, and we usually have music. Oh.
I didn't know if you wanted to make that, because he's got really serious.
Yeah, that's why the music would have been perfect.
Because, you know, everybody has their own opinion why he went in. He knows why he went in. He knows, but whatever he went in for, whatever reason, who knows what he'll find out or learn in 28 days. That's all. So,
does
go
rehab
fuck.
Really make that much of a difference?
Hey, why don't you go fuck yourself? No, I'm looking. No, rehab, listen, here's the thing about rehab for me. Because I was in, 5 days detox, 28 days rehab. Rehab, 28 days of rehab, they told me, is like going to 2 years of meetings. That's what they told me. Because you learn so much about addiction and about yourself. Now, all rehabs are different, so I don't know, and all people are different. All I know is I wanted to quit. I wanted to quit more than I wanted to keep getting high. I couldn't live that way anymore. And the day I got a rehab, I worked in a comedy club. I worked in a bar that night. They said, you've got to quit comedy for a year. Go fuck yourself. Because I knew I wanted not to get high anymore. I worked in a bar that night, and I've never picked up since. So luckily today I'm not picking up, and hopefully things will work out with Anthony.
All right. I appreciate it. Thanks, man.
All right.
Bye.
Boy, that was uncomfortable.
Why so long, though, with it?
Because I'm trying to carry the... Look, we're going to break anyhow, so what am I going to do? I'm going to... Because everybody's asking or going, well, why is he there? Why is he going? Who the fuck? I don't know. I don't know him like that. I just know one thing. It might help him. It might save his life.
Marty from Seattle. Go ahead.
Hey, no, I was just calling up to say I still know why you guys don't have your own TV show.
Oh, you don't know why we don't? Because
there's no justice.
I still know why.
We're not good. Why. Oh, you do know why. Why?
Yeah, I still know. I just know.
What? It's like a secret or?
I think he was fucking around.
Oh, all right.
I'm just being a butt. That's it.
You're the worst, Marty. Do you know that?
Okay,
you're the worst caller we've ever had.
No, he's
thank you.
I like
okay.
him.
But what did he, Marty. A point or was it just like, was it just mean?
I think no. He really started off by saying, I know why you don't have, or I want to know why you don't have a TV show.
Oh, okay.
And then he was trying to be funny by saying, no, I know
oh,
why.
Oh, all right. I was just off the cuff. We're driving. We're not really thinking things through.
Yeah, no, that's all of our callers.
We could hurt someone.
Okay, we have one more call from Kurt Washington.
Hi, this is Kirk Cinnamon.
Mm-hmm. Oh, get ready for a you-know-what.
I just want to tell you how positive everyone's being tonight, and especially Rich Foss.
Yeah.
Oh, in D.C.?
That's it? I thought he was going to... I had my finger on the thing because people would call up and say some really bad words over and over.
Oh, yeah.
He really disguised his intention, though.
Character. I mean, I'm Rick Cinnamon.
Kirk Cinnamon.
That was interesting. Kirk Cinnamon?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm Kirk Cinnamon.
But what was the joke?
I he changed his voice at the end
to say Rich Foss.
Yeah, that was it. It was like
Kirk Cinnamon. Call back so we can analyze what you actually thought.
Took him a half hour to set up the recording system he used to record that because this is all part of his reel.
Oh. I wonder if Jenny, our therapist, is listening to that.
Do you what?
We don't have a real therapist. Oh, Rich would never pay for that.
But we do
have a therapist that calls in sometimes.
Two of them. We have Jeff, the Indian, and Jenny, who I play golf with in California.
Yeah.
So exciting. I don't know why.
Do you have a therapist?
I do.
And have you had the same therapist for years?
Well, a couple of years.
Oh.
Yeah.
In L.A.?
Yeah, in L.A.
In Beverly Hills?
No.
Oh.
No, in Studio City, my friend.
You go
North Hollywood.
You go once a week?
I don't go once a week anymore. And, it took me a while to actually go see this lady because she's also my mother's therapist. And I thought, how fucked up am I that I'm going to see my mother's therapist? But she turned out to be really good.
And so your thing was codependence with your mother?
What? and at the time I was living, that How to Live with Your Parents show
yes, right.
was autobiographical.
Yeah.
I just got my own place. I got my own place, Bonnie.
Yes.
That's like a big fucking news 2 years ago. And my daughter had left.
I was at that place, right?
Yes,
didn't we work
I had
on a script
party.
There?
Yeah. Yeah. And we worked on a script and I had a party and whatever. So then I was.
I don't think I ever got invited to the party now that I think about
I have pictures of you. I have pictures of you at the party, my friend.
Oh, okay. Maybe.
All right, we're going to take a break. Hey, what do you want to plug? Anything?
Plug something.
Yeah, I'm doing it.
Oh, you're at Indianapolis, Morty's.
Yeah, I'm at Morty's in Indianapolis. But this weekend I'm doing a show for a Variety of Kansas City in Kansas City, Kansas.
Oh, okay.
For Variety Magazine?
No, it's the Variety fundraising group, but the
I like how you tried to pass it off though as the magazine.
No, I didn't mean that at all. I didn't even. I'm so far out of the loop. I forgot that there was a Variety magazine. I haven't been featured in that. No exaggeration, in 15 years.
But wait, but what are you doing in Kansas?
It's a
you're on a variety show.
Of illnesses.
No, it's the Variety is a fundraising group, a charity.
Okay.
Yeah.
And for what?
In Kansas City for. The Variety charity.
We don't know.
What is it? We don't know what the.
I think there
is it all diseases.
I don't
cancer.
Know.
Cancer.
I don't know.
It depends what it's.
We do
it
a variety.
They raise money for the NRA. Isn't that correct, Gary?
No.
Isn't that the truth?
Oh, I'm just looking to see which motherfucker won.
So
is this a Bernie fundraiser? Is no, it?
Trump. This weekend I'll be in Lexington, Kentucky, at Comedy Off Broadway. I'm at another level now in comedy, at a whole nother level. Next weekend, Syracuse. The weekend after that, Stress Factory. Bonnie will be at the Stanhope House April 20th, right? April 20th mm-hmm. at 4:20.
A lot of people are asking about your in the neighborhood when you're going to be at
the Stress Factory.
The Stress Factory next, and I didn't.
Don't those people in the neighborhood have fucking Google?
All or? the CrossFit people are going to go.
Oh boy. Claudia, is there anything you want to
I am going to be home tomorrow. Writing. Oh, I worked on the show Crowded. That's on NBC Sundays.
Looks like a good show. That just started, right?
Yeah. It was so much fun. I had a great time in that show. Sundays, after the Carmichael show.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. He's a great guy. Have you met him?
Yeah, he's a super nice guy. He works at the Comedy Cellar.
Yeah, that's not the fucking show. I'm
Crowded.
On the other show.
Crowded with Patrick Warburton, right?
Yeah, Patrick Warburton.
Very talented. Yeah. Patrick Warburton.
Yeah, Carrie Preston. Miranda Cosgrove, if people like her.
Oh, she's from Disney Channel.
When you write on these shows, yeah. And you see your name in the credits. Does yeah. that? Because when I this year when I wrote for the Oscars for my second time.
Oh, nice.
Anyhow, we're gonna go to break.
We got that in.
We'll be back.
Oh, bye.
We have returned to claim the pyramid.
Bonnie, if you know who this is,
on the mothership,
I'll buy you a new pocketbook.
Okay. I hate that term pocketbook, but I'll try anyway. I'm gonna say it's late 60s.
No. 70s.
Oh, 70s.
Some of them from my hometown.
Oh, shit. I think I know, but I can't remember them.
Named after a cigarette.
They're Cools.
No.
Oh.
Sorry, meeting on the air. Don't just send me hate mail. I'm going to stop right now.
A famous.
Is it the Camels?
No.
Is it the
England? It's where they vote in England. It's where
they vote in England.
It's where the Queen hangs out.
The Winchesters. The Winstons.
Parliament.
The Parliament.
Oh, Parliament.
Parliament Funkadelic.
Oh, yeah.
When you said
where they vote, that threw me off.
I thought it was cool in the game.
I didn't think Rich would know that.
What?
Parliament. Where they voted in England.
But also in Canada, they have a Parliament.
Oh. Some of these guys are from my hometown, Plainfield. Right there, Lewis, did you know that?
That's correct.
They used to have a barbershop, George Clinton. They had a barbershop on the west end, I think, on Plainfield Avenue. And Glenn Goins, or one of the Goins who play with the Parliament, is from Plainfield. And Bernie, who's real sick, the War Wool or whatever, was from Plainfield. There you have it. Just a little Plainfield tribute. Give us a call, 866-969-1969. This weekend, Lexington, Kentucky. Comedy Off Broadway next weekend. Syracuse weekend after that. Stress Factory.
We're here with writer-director Claudia Lanau. Lanau.
That's good.
At Claudia Lanau. That's your Twitter. Yeah. And we're here with comedian Gary Gulman. At Gary Gulman.
Do you go on a lot of auditions? Like, I don't get any.
Yeah, no, I hardly ever go on auditions.
Why not?
I don't know. Well, I don't have an agent in that. I only have a personal appearance agent.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
So that's part of it.
Do you have a manager?
I do have a manager. Yeah.
Who's your manager?
Brian Stern.
Oh.
The smartest man in showbiz. That's how I know him.
He's a sharp guy.
He's a sharp, sharp fella. If you have any...
Do you only have people that manage you that look like you? Is that why you went with Brian Stern?
They have to be a certain height?
They have to have great hair.
Gary's a great looking guy.
Yeah, I know. Well, I was just like, I should cast him in something.
Thank you. Yes. I
gotta come up with something.
Yeah, in your sci-fi thriller.
sci-fi thriller about the DJ.
I was in a real movie. I don't called Lucky Them with.
Oh wait, that's the producers of. They're producing the next movie that I'm doing.
It was with Toni Collette. I had a scene with Toni Collette.
Yeah, that's how they knew you, because I said I wanted you in my movie.
Oh, really?
And they were like, we love him.
Oh, that's so cool.
Are we doing a movie, or just you are? The movie you're doing, or are we doing it?
Well, so far, you're in it. You're in it.
So I have nothing to do with...
I wrote a movie that...
Oh, my God.
Hilarious.
That's so cool. Yeah. You're kidding. When did that happen?
Why are you so shocked by that? I do stuff, Claudia.
Well, I haven't seen you for like 8 years.
The only reason I haven't done any producer work on it is because we don't know what we're doing yet. We don't know who we're going with.
I know, but you did open up the bank account today.
I did help you with
for our LLC.
I did help you with the ending.
Yeah, you did. Because I always want my main characters to die.
And I made a show.
I always kill my main characters. And Rich is like, don't kill your main character.
And then I gave you an alternative, and I helped you with the ending. So don't
You're really good at being a script doctor. You really are.
How many movies have I sat on?
Dr. Jeff from Denver. This is our Indian doctor.
Everyone?
This is our Indian
Hi.
Doctor.
How are you?
Good.
What have you learned so far today?
To be honest, I just tuned in right before the break, so I don't even know what's going on. But I figured I'd call because you mentioned the Indian doctor.
Yeah, so hang tight for a second. Let me just ask if Gary has any relationship problems that he needs advice with.
Fair enough.
He's a psychologist.
She won't swallow? Is that the...
No.
I'm sure she will.
That's not an issue.
That's not an issue.
No.
She's like drinking it.
Thank you for taking me seriously, though. I like that one. Float something is a funny moment.
Dr. Jeff, can somebody push your buttons enough where at some point you go enough and kind of snap a little? You know what I mean?
A client or in regular life?
He's talking about me.
I'm talking about my
wife. He says I push his buttons, and then when we're in at a bank or a doctor's office or...
We don't go to the doctors together.
We've done it.
Oh, yeah, for our kid.
Yeah. He'll yell at me in front of people. And it's so uncomfortable.
Not real loud.
But stern enough to be pretty pissed off.
Well, what he said to me was, it's right in your fucking face. So maybe not yelling.
But not kind and loving, to be fair.
And I said to him, I go, can you not, this is like when we got outside to the car, I go, can you not yell at me in front of people? Like at home, I don't care, but don't say things like, and then I was like, what kind of person am I that I'll be like, it's fine other times. I just don't want anyone else to know about it.
Well, I think more than anything, Bonnie, for you, it feels like he's not respecting you because you've asked him not to do that.
That's right. He has no learning curve, as I like to say.
Fucking worst doctor.
No, he might have a learning curve. It sounds like he just doesn't care.
Give us some tools. Don't you have a bag we have to reach into or something?
I got plenty of tools. I got maps. I got tools.
Oh, maps. That's what you're known for, your maps.
Can I say something?
Yeah, go ahead. This is Claudia.
This is Claudia.
Hey, Claudia.
Hi, man. I'm serious that my stepfather has had a terrible temper and was a yeller. And so, but the good thing is that as men lose testosterone, which happens as they get older, they get easier to deal with.
I don't.
He's
I'm not really
delightful.
I'm not really a fucking crazy.
You're not
man.
A yeller.
No, I don't. No, because I'm not once. Maybe once a month.
That's a lot. You know, I mean,
once
I,
a month is a lot to
well,
yell.
Do other people yell at you once a month?
Yeah, two or three times a month. I get a lecture.
No, yelling.
Lecture is not the same as yelling.
Thank you.
Yeah, she yells.
No, I
guarantee. No. It's like,
not
you know,
threatening
I don't,
at all.
Then I don't
not
yell.
Threatening
I don't
at
yell.
All.
I don't yell. Then I never yell because I might raise my voice, but I don't
oh,
yell.
Oh, really, Richard?
I don't yell.
You know, but I mean, I'm just going to say this. This is serious. So I grew up, my stepfather, who's a great guy and was a fantastic stepfather. And, you know, I was with him 5 days, you know, he was my main dad.
Yeah.
Had a terrible temper. And, you know, it's really scared the shit out of me. I finally took him to therapy when I was a grown up and said,
good for you.
And he and my
therapist,
thank you,
of course.
And you know, the therapist was saying, and he got that he had terrified me, and he never hit me, but if you're next to like a bear or a tiger and someone says, don't worry, the bear's not going to hurt you, it's still really scary. And it did make me very angry at him, because I felt like he put my mom in a difficult position because she didn't have the same tools to fight back because she's just not as big.
And yourself in a difficult position, to be fair.
But he get, yeah, because I feel like he gets to get rid of his whatever it is on his chest.
Or a lion.
Yes.
The guy who comes in to add something to something from 3 minutes ago. It's my new character. take it completely off topic.
No.
What are some of the other animals that could be frightening, Rich?
Any animal with fangs.
A boa constrictor. They can,
right. A shark.
A shark.
A raccoon in a day.
What does it mean if your therapist, when you leave, and he's closing the door behind you, but before he closes the door, you hear him go...
I bet there must be people that you hate.
There's people I dislike, but unfortunately, and this is going to sound cliche, but the more you get to know people and you learn the way they were hurt or fucked up, you have a little bit of empathy for them.
Aww.
And people who do come to therapy typically want to come to get better or do something different.
Wow.
Mandated therapy. Totally,
this is a mensch.
Yeah.
Dr.
No,
Jeff is a mensch.
I really feel good about Jeff.
What do you think about...
Going back to yelling for a second, if you don't mind.
We don't really yell that loud.
This is what happens. His anger. He's not able to control his anger, which is just a scary
that's
thing.
That's not true.
Yeah, which is just a scary thing because there's no way to, like, I just have to wait till he's done. But
no.
Then I have all the craziness in me.
She's broken dishes.
And then.
Whoa.
Well, good, because what is she going to do?
I didn't yell. I'm not a yeller. I'm not like you. Don't.
Did
like
you yell
like
at her for breaking the dishes?
No, they were old.
Oh, okay.
I don't remember ever breaking a dish.
You cooked that big dinner one time years ago, years and years ago.
I don't
and
remember
you smashed
this.
The whole thing when I came home. We had an argument about, I don't know,
cocaine.
Whatever. And you.
Because he was like, this is not how I like it.
But anyhow, listen, I don't yell. I don't.
You
I,
get very angry
but I don't
very
yell.
Easily.
I don't yell. I don't yell.
Okay, I'll try one more time.
Okay.
So, irrelevant of yelling or anything, it matters if someone's bringing to conversation a mindset of conflict resolution, of trying to work through something, or trying to win a battle. And it sounds like, Rich, I don't care if you're yelling or talking calmly, if you're there to win a battle,
mm-hmm.
you're not listening, and nothing's going to move forward.
Mm-hmm.
You can be talking in the most calm voice you want. It's worthless.
You want to fuck my wife, don't you?
God, now I'm going to have a fight about this later.
No, listen.
Well, and it doesn't help that you're wrong a lot of the time, Rich.
No, I'm...
Oh, Gary, I thought you were going to do your character from 3 minutes ago.
I was so confused. Bonnie made a motion, and I was like, what do we have to do? What do I have to do?
No, here's the deal. You're right. When I was a kid, I used to get blamed for things I didn't do, and it that's
oh yeah.
Poor
no, not a kid. I remember.
Is that good, pushing the buttons?
So I just
suddenly guys see what he's talking about. Wait, maybe
you should yell at her.
I like to win. Here's the thing. The other couple weeks ago, we were here at the radio station, and my car was in a lot. And if I was there by say 15:45, whatever. I saved $5. I didn't care about the money. I just wanted to get there to know I won. I beat it. Do you understand?
Yeah.
I don't give a fuck about $5. No, not that. Listen, you smelly.
Wow.
I know that's coming.
Did he just drop an anti-Semitic trope on you?
Yes,
about how this is one of the most generous men. With everyone I know, he's generous, even with himself.
Yes. And he's.
But I have seen you go into a bodega and. Bargain about caramels right there.
No, if I spend like 20 bucks in a bodega, right?
For 6,000 years, our lives have been transient. There's been no security. We've been able to lose everything we have at the drop of a hat. Oh, so forgive us if we're a little bit concerned about holding on to our security a little bit harder than the rest of you.
Yeah.
The rest of you have been living.
Fair.
Yeah, talk to the Syrian Jews where everything was taken. Talk to the Syrian Jews where everything was taken from them, okay? Hey, why don't you get some of our artwork back? Some of the artwork that the fucking Christians have, that the fucking Kirk has, okay?
Stop yelling!
I have a friend who, or I know a guy.
like recategorized him.
Right. Well, he's a friend who, like, his father's whole life, he was trying to get the crap back from the Nazis and everything. And then his son kept up on it, and he got a lot of the shit back, and he wrote a book about it.
I'm just trying to get shit back from the coke dealers I owe money to. I don't care about the Nazis. I want my furniture back.
Oh, okay. Well, did that's write, different.
That might be a famous story.
Yeah, the Orpheus clock. It was a. It's not the Helen Mirren movie, but it's like that, where she wanted to get her Klimt painting done.
I wanted to watch that movie for some reason.
You love good, Helen Mirren.
It was a good movie. You're Jewish, right?
Yeah.
Oh, you'll be like, fuck you. That's right. You give me my fucking painting back, you fucking kraut. I mean, that's how you feel at the end. Yeah, I'm going to take that painting. I'm going to fucking do whatever. I'm going to wear it as a dress.
Are you Jewish?
Yes.
Here's what I know. What movie we just saw that was so fucking good? Hello, my name is Doris.
Me too.
Holy fuck, how good was that?
Oh, yeah, Michael Showalter.
I know him. I wrote him. I said, oh, my God, it was so good.
So did I. If Tyne Daly is not up for fucking best supporting actress.
But that's how they get us every year, girls. Because I thought Jenny Slate should have been nominated. Yeah. And Obvious Child should have been nominated. And the writer and director, that girl. And
I don't know who it is.
From
Jenny Slate?
Oh, no,
the Jenny Obvious Child.
Oh, I don't know who did that.
Oh, my God, it was so great. And then the other one was Welcome to Me with Kristen Wiig.
Yes.
I thought, she's got to be nominated. All these people have to be nominated. This is the best thing ever. But, you know.
Yeah, but same with Sally Field was fucking so good in it.
Oh, my God.
How good was that?
Because
movie?
It's so hard to be that over the top and still
and
that grounded. Yes. Yeah.
Yes.
Well, Michael Showalter did a great job. Up until this point, I thought he was mentally handicapped every time that I met him. But he turns out he's a savant or something.
Well, he's directed other things.
Yes?
Yeah.
What did he direct?
Well, I mean,
other movies?
Yeah. The Bachelor.
Hello, my name is Doris. That's the name of the movie?
Yeah, with Sally Field.
You haven't seen it?
Where can you get it?
It's at the theater.
It's in the theaters right now?
On my birthday, Rich took me to the... this is, I guess, because of all the years of oppression that he wouldn't let me have my own popcorn on my birthday.
Yes, I did.
No, you didn't.
I did.
I had a soda and a popcorn, and you said, I'm not getting anything. And I said, because I think I gave you a speech in the car about how I'd really like to have, for once, my own soda. Since we got married, I've never been able to have my own soda when we're out together. He makes me share.
Wow, that is all.
You can, in most places, you can refill the cup.
All right.
A salad works.
I have a little bit of that. My boyfriend always wants to eat my food, and he's got a big plate of food, and I keep saying to him, I have an eating disorder, and I'm an only child. Get your hands off my food.
Well,
this is my food. We planned this food.
This is
and
Rachel
this is
do.
All the food that's
take his fork, and he'll go like this with his face and move some of the things around on your plate to see what he wants. It drives me bonkers.
It's a pretty funny thing. Guys can eat as much as they want.
Jeff, thank
no,
you.
No, he's like living with an Olsen twin. He's so concerned about his weight. He's on a fast right now. No, a juice cleanse.
Yeah, I'm quitting tonight. This is ridiculous. Because what's it going to do?
No, you got to see this through.
Do you?
You got to see this through.
Why?
You really do.
Because you started it. Something.
And you got to finish
Diets are the only products that have a 95% failure rate.
Yes.
What other products could you buy that would fail?
How about husbands?
Sounds like a
bit. I agree with you, Jeff. I agree with you. As a recovered eating disorder person.
How about flying out of Newark Airport?
Did you? What kind of eating disorder did you have?
Fucking eating too much, Bonnie.
Wait, you were never fat, were you?
Yeah, I was chubby.
No.
My stepfather had me on a diet for 4 years.
I lived with a girl that used to take 60 laxatives a day.
Oh, that's crazy.
Oh, God.
I'm not that.
45, Rich. I took 45.
I never did the anorexia or the bulimia.
She was fucking smoking hot, though.
Yeah. Well,
pray for anorexia.
No.
She was so hot.
You know what? I mean,
I want a little bit of that control.
I a little bit would be nice.
Dr. Jeff, thank you for calling
thank you,
and thank you for helping us.
Dr. Jeff, you never help us. You know that, right?
I never help. I'd like to dwell on that.
To go live with Dr. Jeff.
Thank you, Dr. Jeff.
What did he say to you?
He said he was a huge fan. And,
and I hate grapefruit.
Yeah, but he said under his breath, chew.
I wasn't trying to say it under my breath. I was getting fucked up.
You thought he said hot chew, but he didn't.
Thanks, Dr. Jeff.
Thank you, Dr.
Take
Jeff.
It easy.
Yeah.
866-969-1969. We will do here today what Dr. Jeff has never done for us, is that we will fix your life. So if you have a relationship problem, call in right now. Claudia, I'm sure, has great relationship advice.
Oh, my
advice.
God, it's the best.
Her first bit of relationship advice, live in separate houses.
Were you told that we have to do this tonight?
Don cornered me in the back. He said, let's get back to what really makes your show work.
Really?
Which is you fighting with Rich. I mean, I'm in love with you right now. I'm just doing all this because I was told that's the fucking show. You know, I want to walk over there and sit in your lap and be cuddly, but... You don't like
enough.
That. Anytime I try to cuddle him, he goes, buzz off.
No, I say scram.
Oh, scram.
Scram. That's like Little Rascals talk.
Scram. Yeah.
Scram. Scram. Get out of here. Come on. Let's scram.
You and your gal cuddle?
Oh, yeah. Here? Yeah. We're pretty cuddly.
You guys are
yeah.
like the kind of like that I daydreamed once about and then I settled. But I have like, you read the New York Times together on Sunday and
hey,
stuff.
And me and Jonathan do all that shit,
oh, you
too.
Do? Yeah,
we cuddle
yeah,
and
I can
read
see.
The New York Times.
Yeah.
I don't read.
No, he's not finished my book yet.
No, I only got like two chapters to go.
Yeah, but which two chapters?
The last two.
Oh.
He read them consecutively.
No, I'm going to read. It's just when you're on the road, it's hard to lay in a room and read about, you know, your wife's ex-boyfriend. It's not easy. It's not easy.
I can see that.
It's not an easy read.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, I can see that.
Oh, yeah, but while we're having sex, it's all you want me to talk about.
No.
I mean, it's bizarre.
No, because... Well, one was good at crowd work.
Stop.
He's all right.
Oh, are you looking
at
nice
this
guy?
Week is the fucking Masters.
Oh, my God.
866-969-1969. Rich, you can't talk about golf. Don told me that when he was saying...
No, but I will say this. If you're in L.A. and you want to go to golf with someone, call my boyfriend because he is golfs now.
Oh, you don't, now? Oh, he just started?
No.
All right. No.
Rich is really good, so he's like...
Not really good. I'm okay.
You got a 10 handicap, isn't that true?
No, I'm about a 12.
That's not bad.
I don't know what any
it's really
of this
good.
Means.
I asked somebody in the audience the other night, what's your handicap? And then they said 10. And I was like, that's bullshit. It's probably more like 15. But I really didn't know what I was talking about. That just means strokes over par?
Yes.
Okay.
Your average. If par 72, which it is most places, if you shoot average, say, 83, you're an 11.
Let's talk about something else, because okay. I just can't even stand to hear about it.
You don't like golf? Do you not like your boyfriend playing because he goes away for 4 hours?
No, that I don't care. I don't live with him, so he can do whatever he wants. And I'm always say, you do what you want to do, and I'll do what I want to do.
What hobbies do you have?
Me? I like to watch TV.
I know. I was thinking about that the other day. Like, does anyone have another hobby? I mean, that's what people do.
I take sewing classes. I have friends.
Did you just say take
sewing classes?
Okay, but I want to take sewing classes.
You went over that like you just blew that out. Like,
that's a hobby.
You
make some clothes and shit. But
do you want to go on Project Runway?
Golf is for
I'm
the rich.
I'm not that good.
Yeah. Golf is for the rich.
No,
it's your character.
If you ever watch the Golf Channel
all the time,
how many ads for payday loans are there on the on the Golf Channel, or mesothelioma lawsuits?
Yeah, no,
none.
Hey,
none.
What is that mesh vagina thing? Do you know what it is?
I don't know, but it sounds like very bad news.
Oh,
what
God.
Are you talking about?
A mesh
about?
Vagina?
How about talcum powder?
We're in a class action lawsuit over talcum powder.
Why? What
uterine
happened?
Cancer.
Apparently, it's causing uterine cancer.
Who's putting it on their vag?
Who wants some dry vag with fucking powder on it?
Oh, my God.
It's like
my vag is so greasy.
I gotta powder my fucking...
Do you think black families should start off with an extra 100 points on Family Feud because the questions are always racially biased?
Oh, yeah, sure.
Yeah, sure.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to say that.
Yeah, okay. But I feel like that would be uncomfortable for them as well.
Well, no.
Like, it's time to play the family feud. We have the white family and the black family, and of course, black family, you get 100 points because you don't know anything.
I saw one the other day.
Well,
listen, they should get $400 extra because they had to take the bus down.
Listen to this.
What?
The question was, name a profession that is untrustworthy. The guy said, police.
Oh, man.
Wow.
You saw that on the show?
Weatherman was on there.
Oh, God.
Weatherman
right.
was on there.
Scary.
The question is, they say 100 people were surveyed, 100 white people were surveyed.
Oh, yeah.
100 Lily white people were surveyed.
I like
Weatherman, not police.
Gary, I like that you're doing this kind of investigation, but I think you should also do what's that one where they do the antiques? You know, where they tell you how much your antiques.
Oh, yeah.
Take this.
Oh, stop it. I'm in the middle of something.
But this is important.
Who gives a shit? They can wait for 5 fucking minutes.
Hey.
Sorry.
You did yell.
Sorry.
She does it all the time.
No, but Don told me to yell at
Don
you a couple
said it's
times.
Okay.
He said that's what our show is based on.
No, then we'll get to the end. Just, I got to take this real quick.
Okay. Is it my friend?
Bob.
Yo.
Hey.
Bob, would you have waited, just for argument's sake, would you have waited 2 minutes there on hold?
Yeah.
Well, I finished my story. Thank you.
I'm sorry, Bonnie. Just because I saw it, I don't know how long you were there.
I said to him, do the phones. Do the fucking phones. It's the same with the remote. He won't learn how to use the remote, but will he just sit back and let me do the remotes?
That's it. You got to watch TV in your own room.
No. He just goes.
In your own house.
He's on the wrong channel. Oh, you got to, like, you know, when you're TiVoing and sometimes it goes a little past. Oh, you get to way too far. It's like.
Bob.
Yeah. Yeah.
Sorry,
who's your famous friend you always brag about that your kids play basketball with?
Do I brag about?
Well, that you say you're friends with because your kids play basketball with his kids or something.
Michael Rapaport?
Oh!
Bingo.
Oh!
Yes.
Oh, is this Bob Gollum?
Yeah.
Hi, Bob!
Who's this?
Claudia.
Oh, Claudia, how are you?
Michael's brother, hello, Claudia. Claudia Lano.
She's the only person.
Oh, Michael, I haven't seen Michael for a while, actually. I think he's been back and forth to New York.
Yeah.
He's doing I Am Rappaport. You know, he's doing it. I haven't seen him.
Is that a reality show?
No, he's got a podcast. I Am Rappaport.
Oh.
Yeah, the Rappapack.
But he's on Stern a lot, too.
He's on Stern a lot. And he's got a movie in Tribeca coming up, you know.
Well, Bob has a pretty good movie.
Whoa. You know what? Do me a favor.
What?
Anytime you start with pretty good.
No. Yeah, that's... Yeah.
No, I mean, I was trying to be, you know, I didn't want to, you know, sound like a fucking groupie. He has a really good movie.
I'm not a groupie, but, you know, a long time ago, I used to say, look, remember my one-man show, I'd say, either hate me or love me, but don't think I'm okay. And the New York Post reviewed it, said it's just okay, but that's not good. That's honest to God's truth. And you know what? The funny thing, when we did it at L. Martin's place years ago, that we couldn't get anybody in, so we had to ask. He said an improv group was coming down to audition. He said, how many of you got? He goes, 15. He said, bring them all. That was our audience when the guy came and reviewed me. We couldn't get anyone to come. It was like our first, second show. But, yeah, Mike's a great dude, man.
Yeah. What's the movie?
Oh, the movie's called Die Laughing.
Oh, okay.
It's called a stand-up comic serial killer.
Oh, cool.
Oh, how do we get it, Bob?
Go to his house and watch it.
Well, we're opening. No, we're opening in San Diego. We're opening in L.A.
In theaters?
In theaters.
Oh, you already have it? It's already completely edited and done now?
It's been fucking done for a long time, but I was held up because I had working on a TV deal with, I'm not going to mention his name, in New York, and he couldn't get it done. And he held me up for about a year nicely. I mean, look, you know, things happen. And I wouldn't want to release it, and I didn't want to release it because we thought it would hurt the TV portion of it. So now we got it going now, and then now we're going to kick it back the other way and do it as a series, you know. But we're opening in San Diego, a beautiful place, and then, I mean, it's fantastic. It's the best. I got to tell you, honest to God, this place is the best fantastic theater you ever been at.
Theater's a fucking theater.
I was doing an impression of Trump. I mean, Jesus Christ. But it's the best, the fantastic economy. But no. But we're doing, we got a place in L.A. called Sin Family.
Sin Family, yeah.
Yeah. And they're going to do it. And then, of course, New York. And then, you know, we're doing our own thing. And then we're going to go down to Florida. We got a place in Florida. So, you know, we're going to do it that way. Grab a little heat and then try to get someone to release it, you know, properly. Because you go to these fucking festivals, you spend $80. It's bullshit.
It's bullshit, honest. Bob.
$80. That's fucking bullshit.
Yeah, first, if you're accepted to South by Southwest or any of them, you fucking do it. You don't have to go to big festivals. We went to some small festivals, and that's what created our heat, and that's what got us a distributor. The one festival we did, the Athena, what was it, Bonnie? The Athena film?
Athena.
It was all female directors. We did that. We did a small one.
Women are taking over, by the way, and I'm glad. Explain this to me. Okay, you guys, there's two women there. This is no bullshit, okay? The women's, this is the God's truth, the women's hockey, I mean, a soccer, the women's soccer did better numbers, almost by one-third better numbers than the men's, and they're getting paid like 70% on the dollar, which is bullshit because they did better numbers, so the numbers are right in front of them. It's unbelievable, but go ahead.
Who did better numbers?
The women's soccer. Oh. You know, but I'll tell you, because I've been thinking about this a lot lately, because there's a lot of movies with women on them, you know, make a lot of money, especially in the last 5 years. But all of that bullshit continues, and I always thought, well, it's about the numbers. When you get down to it, numbers are the only thing they care about.
I used to think that all the time.
That's
it,
you know, and we just got to get better numbers, and numbers is all they care about. And you know what? It is not about the numbers. They don't give a fuck about the numbers. They will pretend the numbers are just a fluke and fuck you over.
Yes, well, that's what happens on the road whenever I fucking headline. It's like... I guess this is with everybody. They just won't let you, like sell out these shows, and then they're just like, yeah, well, you know.
But if TV is based on numbers.
Yes, I mean, Bob.
And the numbers were there. Now you know what, they're suing, so they'll get the money. And guess what they're going to get? They're going to probably get back pay. Someone said, oh, you know, you're pro-women. You're trying to get a development. Pro-woman. Not pro-women?
Yeah, why? What? But you're pro-human. It's like, right? And you got a fought, you got a daughter, and, you know, it's just, I mean, that's great for you. That's nice, Bob, you know, because you need dudes to, say, this is bullshit.
Yeah, but Bob, if you, like, I know Bob for, I don't know, 30 years. He is probably one of the dumbest people I've ever met. He is so...
Whoa, wait. I will admit I'm not that intellectual. I'm not that book smart. But what I do know is numbers. And all I know is, I'm going to go back to it, because you're not going to get me off topic like you do to Trump and shit like that. See, the end of the day is numbers. The numbers were there.
When?
I swear to God, look them up. If the numbers are there, the team...
The end of the day?
Everyone
sees it, where's
the fucking money?
I'm with you. But I'm saying it's not about numbers.
I am a little dumb, too.
Anyhow, listen...
What is at the beginning of the day? Hookers and cocaine? Out of curiosity.
Hey, Bob, we got to run, because we only got like 10 minutes. Thanks for calling, and I'll talk to you.
Bye, Bob.
I'm coming in town in a few weeks, so maybe we'll do it.
Bye.
You're going to be in New York?
Oh, shit, I just hung up on him. Sorry, I didn't mean to. I said bye. I thought it was over. I didn't know.
All right, so were you talking to a guy about the antique?
No, I want to talk about this now. Do you think, like, it's better for women in this business, the writer-director part of it, than it used to be?
Yeah, it's definitely better. Everything's better than it used to be.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, I mean, there's
We can vote. We can vote.
No, but I mean, it's even better than... I mean, look, it's better than when my mom was doing stand-up. It's way better. Everything's better. You know what? When you think about, like the entirety of history, just what has happened in the last 100 years is unbelievably great.
Yeah.
And yet, you look around and it's still frustrating. But... I think you also have to think about, well, I mean, just think about it. 50, 60 years ago, you know, even what we're doing right now would be so unusual, I don't think it would ever happen. And that's like, you know, so it's not going to change overnight.
So
it's easy to get really pessimistic and downhearted, but think about what it's been like since you've been alive. Yes.
Yeah, but here's how I look at it. When you group, you can group anybody and go, women, Blacks, Jews. I think it's an individual thing. I think it's tough for, unless you come from money, I think it's tough no matter what you're doing if you want to get to the top of what you're doing.
That's true, but there is a thing called white privilege, which you're born with a leg up no matter what you think.
I don't think I have it. You look at me, I don't have white privilege. If I did,
you just
I'd be
look at your actual skin to determine that.
No, I'm just saying, if I did,
no,
I'd be
I know
a
you don't think that no, you have no, no. it. But it's... the truth is that you really, the things like like, you know, you can go into a place, like, say you want to go into a hotel lobby and just wait for someone, and
not
you
if
know
there's blacks there.
You know you're not going to be asked to leave. But maybe a black person thinks, oh, I can't go in there because they'll ask me to leave.
I'm going to play.
Is that fair, Lewis? Can you weigh in?
That makes sense. What you're trying to say is that if he were to go to a bodega, he wouldn't be followed around.
Yeah, right.
Whereas I would.
But back in
the day when I had long hair.
I'm actually stealing.
When I had long hair, I was followed everywhere. I had a criminal look.
But, well.
Had?
Well, let me just. I mean.
Put that hat back on.
I think you're being funny because it's ridiculous to say you don't have any white privilege. But on
no,
the
I
other
No, I think he
hand,
really believes that he doesn't.
No, I don't believe
I've talked
that.
To a lot of people recently.
I don't
believe they have white privilege.
Well,
they don't think it's real.
I don't consider myself
insane.
White. I'm a Jew. I'm not white.
But well, I won't consider
myself a white man either. I'm a Jew.
I don't consider myself entirely white either because of the Jew thing. But
I've considered myself pure.
My boyfriend.
That's
so fucking white.
That's white.
But the thing is, just in terms of like business, like I've been the only woman in a writer's room and. Uh-huh. I was in a situation and I was really having, I mean, I'd pitch things and that's a funny joke for a girl, like shit like that. And I was a little tense. And so then I started to analyze all the other reasons why I was having trouble fitting in that I could fix.
And what were some of those?
I was new. The guy knew everybody else in the room. He was working with me for the first time.
Right.
And so I try to focus on, well, what can I can't do anything about being a girl.
Mm-hmm.
So let's fix these four other things. And by the end of that time, I was having a great time. You know, it was fine. So it's true that this business is impossible. And there's a million reasons why it's hard. One of them might be because you're a woman, but you can't do anything about that one. So you got to focus on the other ones. It could be true, but who gives a shit? What are you going to do about that?
But I think everybody's their own worst enemy. I think women are their own worst enemies towards other women. I think black people are.
I think 20 years ago,
no,
maybe.
I think the KKK is the people's worst enemy.
No, but you know what I'm saying. You notice men in comedy will help men out more than it looks.
I think it's hard for women sometimes
comedy,
to network.
It's so different. You can't. Yeah. The numbers are ridiculously skewed. I mean, there's like 70 dude. There's a lot more shitty male comics.
Oh yeah, you don't have to tell me.
But that's because there's just more male comics.
I'm pro women.
Yeah, no, but we're not arguing. It's just
you
like
are.
Dating.
This is the first time I didn't know that.
Oh, you don't think I'm pro?
I always think of you as homosocial.
I didn't say I. Listen, I have three.
He only likes
three
hanging
daughters.
Out with men.
I have three. No, I like hanging out with fucking aggressive, funny women.
Oh.
You know, at the table? Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah, okay, yeah.
Yeah, what, are you kidding me?
Oh, okay. You don't like emotional women.
Diffident women.
I actually don't like hanging out when I go to the cellar or something. I want to hang out at that table if we're just talking about comedy. Like, I'm past the point when girls try to corner me to talk about their boyfriends. I'm not interested at all.
Yeah, I want to talk comedy. That's what we go there for.
Right.
We go to the comedy store to hang out and talk comedy.
Actually, that's not true. I do like talking about boyfriends. I just realized. That's all I talk about with some of my... Okay, so that's not exactly true.
Oh, we got 3 minutes. What were you talking about, the antique...
Antique Roadshow. You know, I've only ever seen one black guy on that show, and the host was like, where'd you get this?
Oh, my gosh.
Are you kidding?
That's hilarious.
I can't
do that in your act. You should do that in your act. That's so funny.
That is funny. But I bet they do not have that show in Germany. Because if you're like, well, I got it from somewhere.
Yes, right.
I mean, but he's dead now. So what are we going to do about it?
My grandfather stole it from.
Oh, all this shit. We have no idea.
Yeah.
the people who lived here before.
Yes. Yes.
All right. Is that a caller? I'm like helping her with the screen.
Okay, white privilege is bullshit, but we only have one minute for him. Go ahead, Adam, in 1 minute, speak your mind.
Speak my mind. Well, white privilege is bullshit. I'm 6'1", big white guy, bald head, big beard, and I've seen people push me out of places when a black guy gets to stay. So white privilege is bullshit.
What kind? What were you doing that you were getting kicked out? Like, I don't understand.
Walking into a store. I ride motorcycles.
There you go. Your beard is scraggly. You're wearing a lot of leather. I'm afraid of you.
I'm not.
I think you're a skewed.
Was the black guy wearing a bow tie? That can overcome.
No. Were you wearing your colors?
I don't have colors.
Oh, okay.
I ride a motorcycle, but I wear leathers to be protected when I'm riding.
But I would be afraid of a big guy.
Yeah.
I mean, because men are frightening. Men are frightening.
No, they're not.
They are to me.
They're talking about white privilege. He's talking about in the board. White privilege is in the boardroom when it comes to making decisions.
No. White privilege is really just on a day-to-day basis things that you have as like tools in your toolbox that you don't even know that you have that people of color might not have.
Oh, you're so Canadian.
And the lady there just made a major.
The lady. Sir.
I don't know her name.
That's male privilege.
I don't know her name. I'm sorry. I don't know her name.
It's Bonnie.
Very nice.
Okay.
But, no, the one that made the assumption about bikers.
Oh, Claudia.
Oh, not bikers. I didn't say bikers.
Sorry.
I didn't say bikers. I said that men can be frightening. If I'm on an elevator frightening. If I'm on an elevator and a guy of any stripe gets on, you know, immediately your, you know, like spidey sense goes up to assess, am I going to be okay? You know,
I've never thought about that in an elevator.
Oh my God, an elevator? Yeah.
Oh, we got to go.
Oh, because he could rape you in the elevator?
Thanks for the call, Adam.
Oh my God, I didn't know
that. All right,
have
fun.
Okay. Thanks for the call.
Bye.
Gary.
He's a nice guy, though.
Yeah.
Larry, what are you plugging? What do you got?
If he was black, we would have talked to him a little bit longer.
I'm going to be at Morty's in Indianapolis next weekend. Not this coming weekend, but the weekend
great
after.
Great club.
The 11th, the 9th, 10th, and 11th?
Yeah.
Why does it say, isn't it 2016?
All right. Don't stumble through it.
He wrote 15 on
Bonnie will be at the Stanhope House April 20th. This week I'm in Lexington, Kentucky, Comedy Off Broadway. Next week in Syracuse, Funny Bone. Weekend after that, Stress Factory. Go to richvoss.com. Claudia, how can they find you?
Oh, I'm on Twitter. I got a
@Claudia.
@ClaudiaLano on Instagram.
You were great. Both of you. This was one of my favorite radio shows.
Oh, that's
this
good.
Was. I
like Race Force.
All right. We're out of here.
And on that.